Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nest Egg by Josi Avari. Narrated by Angie Hickman. Chapter 1. It shouldn't have been such a surprise for Saffron to see a chicken in a pot. But the chicken was alive, and the pot was filled with straw, and the sound the chicken was making made Saffron doubt that anyone had told it that Uncle Bo had left the Hawaiian house it was nesting in to her. The door was slightly open, and had been for some time. None of the doors were locked, Saffron had discovered, and it was a good thing because the lawyer had said there were no keys to the house. When Saffron had inquired incredulously how that could be, he'd explained that nobody in the sleepy little island town of Maikai ever locked their doors anyway, and Uncle Bo had likely lost the keys long ago. She was standing just inside the back doorway, the bright tropical morning reaching its warm fingers into the dingy interior of the house. Saffron took off her ever-present sunglasses. She had just driven up from Honolulu, and the turquoise and white of the ocean, the vibrant pink of the flowers on the trees lining the long driveway off the main road, and the flashes of golden sand she'd seen driving along the coast, still danced in her head. The vibrance outside made starker the dusty browns and grays of the cluttered house. Color was an extraordinary experience for Saffron. She saw more colors than most people, and in different ways. She never understood, for example, why people said she had red hair. When she looked in the mirror, she saw strands of orange and gold. She saw some that were wine-colored and some nearly yellow. Altogether, they made up a shining copper that was as foreign to her idea of the red of an apple as it was to the green of the grass. Her mother, who had passed away a few years ago, had been one of the few people who realized that Saffron had a unique eye for color. She had learned it early on, when she'd enrolled her daughter in free painting classes at the local youth center. The endeavor hadn't gone well, because the teacher had insisted that the students use green for trees and blue for skies and gray for buildings, regardless of what color they actually were. Saffron knew the sky in 100 shades of pink and violet, the trees in blues and browns and creams. She couldn't bear to misrepresent them by reducing them to a single color. The self-portrait she'd been told to do for the class was a disaster, too. She looked in the mirror and saw her skin as peachy salmon, a color not encompassed in the basic crayon box. It was brushed across her cheeks with cherry and across the forehead with pale azure. Her freckles were 100 shades. The teacher had argued that all she needed was a tan crayon and a brown one, and Saffron had been forced to hoard her colors and blend them as best she could. She spent 5 times as long on her portrait as anyone else, so the teacher had kicked her out. Sometimes, Saffron liked to say that she was an art school dropout. That's why she kept her sunglasses handy. They helped dull the colors, so that she didn't see things so differently than other people. It cut down on awkward conversations. Now, without them, the dingy interior of the bungalow was a still life of muted golds and reds, pinks and browns. They were a relief to her eyes. The color in the verdant island outside was a shock after coming from the gray of Washington, D.C. The chicken in the pot wasn't the only chicken in the kitchen either. Another scrawny bird scrambled out of Saffron's way as she pushed the door open. He was a young rooster, with long legs and bright orange pointed feathers laced with pale gray tips falling across his back like a costume. He scuttled over to the far side of the room as Saffron took a look at the sprawling bungalow her Uncle Bo had called home. Saffron tried not to panic. This place was not her style. She tugged a bottle of hand sanitizer out of her purse, a nervous habit, and smoothed it on her hands as she tried to force herself to venture farther. She tucked the bottle back into the small pocket in the lining of her purse that was designated for it, and turned her face back to the open door. She took a tremulous breath of the sweet morning air. Saffron's purse wasn't like other purses. She didn't toss everything in at random. She carried nothing she didn't need, and everything she needed had a place. A wallet inside held her checkbook, cards, and cash. Her driver's license was in a side pocket, lip gloss and powder in another pocket. There were no errant sticks of gum, no lidless pens, no unidentifiable crumbs at the bottom. It was, like everything in her life, perfectly organized. She had her purse, a suitcase, and an envelope from the lawyer. Inside it was a sheaf of papers that made up a comprehensive insurance document, complete with photos of all the valuables in the house after her uncle's death. She hadn't looked through it yet, but the front page said she was to verify that the items were, in fact, in the house when she took possession of it. Now she saw that checking what was there would be a significant task. She tried to breathe. The suitcase she carried onto the wide lanai held exactly 1 week's worth of tops, skirts, jeans, shoes, and matching jewelry, all rolled into neat cylinders and stacked for easy access. Her rental car was devoid of soda cans or stray receipts, as pristine as when she'd picked it up. Atop the shock of seeing the true state of the place, she was jet-lagged from the 5 hours she'd lost flying to Hawaii from Washington, D.C., and the humidity had already undone her sleek and straightened hairstyle. The natural waves of her strawberry curls were beginning to assert themselves. Though she carefully touched up her day-old makeup before she'd exited the plane, the humidity had misted every available patch of skin, and she could tell her careful mask was disappearing. She felt as askew as this place looked. There were piles everywhere. Old crates and boxes, once damp Aloha shirts draped out to dry, and books and photo frames stacked on every available surface. This was chaos. Saffron didn't do chaos. Her event planning business back in D.C. was called Every Detail Events, and she had a reputation for events where even the smallest particulars were taken care of. Her apartment, her life, had been the same way. It had come to define not just her business, but also everything else. She closed her eyes a moment and pictured her 700-square-foot studio apartment in the Yardley building back in D.C., or what used to be her apartment anyway. She'd sold her lease before coming here, hoping to make enough on the sale of this place to buy a chic office space back in D.C. with an apartment above. Right now, she missed the Yardley. Her flat there had been all steel and glass and sanitizable surfaces. She had opted for tile instead of wood, a leather sofa, glass end tables, and steel countertops. Nothing but the feet of her sparse furniture touched the floor. She had decorated in charcoal gray, black, and white, because they showed dust the best, and it could be removed quickly. Decor was timeless, not seasonal. Two hand-blown glass faces in a rich blood red were the only art she allowed in. Back home, she employed a house cleaning service weekly and scrubbed the apartment herself nightly. Before Reggie had left, he had told her, "I just need a little more chaos in my life," as he tried to explain to her why their relationship wasn't working for him. She had responded, "I don't do chaos." Yet, here she was, and opening her eyes, she saw that there was no other word for this place. This was chaos upon chaos. In addition to the obvious hoarding, it looked as if someone had rifled through some of the boxes lately. She supposed the lawyer would have had to uncover her contact information somehow. The dust here was unlike the dust in D.C. Back home, it collected in sharp black grit on the tops of side tables and chair rungs. Here, it clung soft and heavy to nearly every surface, vertical or horizontal. In addition, a fine moss grew on the windowsills, and vines snaked in through the windows, which her uncle had apparently left slightly open. Something else had been left open. Saffron reached out and touched a tile from the backsplash that looked to be hanging away from the wall. It swung easily, and she pulled her hand back in surprise as she saw, behind it, a perfect little compartment. Saffron pushed the tile back to the wall, where it disappeared into the mosaic pattern of the backsplash. Intrigued, she tapped at it again, but this time it didn't budge. It took 2 minutes of playing with it before she found that the key was to push in on the top left corner. It gave under her fingers and then sprung open. She inspected it and discovered a catch and a hinge. It was a secret compartment built into the wall. An empty secret compartment. Saffron pushed it closed and turned back to the disaster that was the kitchen. "So much for moving to paradise," she said to the chicken. Not that Saffron had ever lived with the misconception that Hawaii was paradise. Her mother, Abigail, had made sure of that ever since Saffron's father left. She had been almost certain that he'd come back to Hawaii, and she'd taken every opportunity to tell Saffron what an unpleasant place it was. Since her father had never come back, and since he'd never made any effort at contacting her, Saffron assumed he was dead. Part of her hoped he was, since the thought of him out in the world somewhere, living his life while she suffered through her mother's loss alone, made Saffron desperately angry. Last year, Saffron's boyfriend Reggie had repeated history and run off to Hawaii too. He had chosen a promotion in the Honolulu office of his medical supply company over the promotion he was offered in the DC office. Though he'd been sure he could convince her to move there, he couldn't, and that had effectively been the end of that relationship. She hadn't contacted him since he'd left the mainland, and she wasn't looking him up now. She was glad that they'd had absolutely no contact for the last year. That made it easy to avoid seeing him for the short time she was on the island. She didn't even have his contact information anymore. Saffron had no desire to stay any longer than it would take to tidy this place up and sell it. She'd really only come because of a vague curiosity about what might be in those boxes. When the realtor had sent her some photos of the place, she'd seen her father's name, Slate Skye, on the corner of a page sticking out from a crate. So she'd come to see what other secrets the house might hold. But she hadn't had any idea it would be this big a job. Of course, it had been nearly a year since Uncle Boa died, and the place had been left wild in his absence. Even before that, it appeared, Uncle Bo had been living pretty wild himself. According to Gilbert Simmons, the lawyer who'd handled the will, Saffron was the only family Uncle Bo had left. Uncle Bo had married when he was young, but his wife, Saffron's Aunt Isla, had died in a car accident with their young son just a few years after the wedding. Uncle Bo had never brought anyone into his life again. Saffron wanted to turn around and get out of there, hop a plane, and go straight back to D.C. But her apartment at the Yardley was gone, probably carpeted and redecorated in mustard and teal by the chipper young Midwestern couple she'd sold her lease to. There was no place to go back to. Besides, she could do this. She'd cleaned up many a venue before the perfect wedding. The abandoned warehouse in the Union Market section of D.C. came to mind. She transformed that eyesore into an enchanted garden in 3 weeks. She could do this. The first step was to remove the livestock. Saffron approached the young rooster on the floor, wondering how to get him out of the house. She reached for him, but he effortlessly flapped out of the way. She chased him around the kitchen table, which was laden with papers and boxes and crates. He observed her with one beady eye. Saffron decided to slow down. Maybe if she didn't look so eager, he'd forget she was coming after him. She walked away, then circled back around the table as he got interested in some spilled cereal and began scratching and pecking at the floor. That was encouraging. Saffron paused, noticing that under and behind all the clutter was a pretty standard kitchen setup. Stove with chicken, sink, dishwasher, microwave. But there was something odd. There were two refrigerators, one near the door and one back in the corner by the table. The one by the table was avocado green, and the other was a relatively new stainless steel model. Both were unplugged, and their doors propped open. The rooster's scratching drew her attention again, and Saffron moved toward him. She sidestepped around the table, keeping her eyes toward the stove but maneuvering closer to the bright little bird. As she neared, he took an easy step or two away from her, but didn't flee too far. As she closed the distance, his spindly legs suddenly went into overdrive, and he sped away like a roadrunner with a couple brisk flaps of his wings for extra speed. "This is what they mean when they say something is as useless as herding chickens," she told him. "Now come on, we're not both going to stay here." The rooster chose that moment to let out a strangled sound. Not a clear cock-a-doodle-doo like she'd heard cartoon roosters make. There was a note of defiance in it. Saffron looked at him. "You really can't stay if you're going to make sounds like that. I need some sleep." Maybe she could lure him close, then catch him. Scooping up a handful of spilled cereal, Saffron crouched down and held out her hand. "Here, Chick Chick," she said. "Here, boy." Reggie had been the proud father to a dog, a brindle boxer named Rocky, and this had always worked with him. Of course, he hadn't had much to hide behind at the Yardley. When Reggie and Rocky visited Saffron's apartment, there had barely been enough room for the three of them. The chicken seemed completely uninterested in the food. He wandered away from her, back around the table, and leaped onto Saffron's luggage, where he started pecking at the Union Jack sticker from her trip to create the perfect London wedding last spring. The door stood open behind him. Maybe she didn't need to catch him just now. Instead, Saffron ran at him, throwing her arms up, scattering the cereal as she did so. The rooster let out a surprised bawk and flapped off through the open door onto the wide lanai that wrapped all the way around the farmhouse. Saffron slammed the door with a feeling of accomplishment. Now she was met with a quandary. Should she keep cleaning or get some rest? The hen was sitting quietly now, and though it would have to go, her red-eye flight was catching up with her. Investigating the house, she found that there were three bedrooms, a living room, two bathrooms, and the kitchen, all filled with stuff. Only two spaces were cleared enough to be of much use to a human being, half the futon in the living room, and a narrow area on the bed in the master bedroom where Uncle Beau must have slept. Saffron herself could never close her eyes on that bed. She'd have to clear it first. Saffron went back to the luggage in the kitchen and pulled a bottle of orange juice from her bag. "It's going to be a long day," she told the chicken in the pot. Though Saffron had heard a lot about sea turtles and monk seals, chickens were the most visible wildlife in Hawaii. Saffron scattered a little flock of roosters on her way through the parking lot of the town's small hardware store. Coconuts and bolts. She was wearing a broad sun hat that she'd picked up, and she stopped to smooth on some sunblock. Her peachy skin had taken on a definite rosy hue since she'd gotten here, and she didn't want to go all the way to tomato. She'd had enough sunburns in her life to take the precautions to avoid them. Cleaning supplies were expensive in Hawaii. In the store's home care section, where Saffron found some cleaner, buckets, gloves, and scrub brushes, prices were sometimes twice what she would have paid back home. But there was no way around it. The bungalow had to be cleaned. She also found a set of pillows and hideous blue sheets printed with surfboards. There were plush towels printed with pineapples, and she picked those up as well. She was hauling it all to the front when she heard a warm voice behind her. "Bathing chickens out on the egg farm?" Saffron turned to see a square man with a lined face the color of kukui nuts. His teeth were wide and straight, and his eyes creased like seashells at the corners. His white beard, neatly trimmed, softened the strong line of his jaw. He wore a red and white Hawaiian shirt. "Excuse me?" she said.
"You're the girl taking over the Hauʻolikamoa egg farm, right?"
"I'm the one cleaning it up to sell it," she said. The old man's face clouded, then cleared.
"But you'll be staying while you clean it up, eh?"
She nodded.
"And you'll want to get top dollar for it."
"Naturally."
"So you'll want it cleaned pretty well. I've seen it. That's a big job there."
It made Saffron's head hurt to think of it. "I know," she said, edging toward the checkout. In D.C., you didn't have to talk to people in the store.
"Used to make a lot of money, that farm,"
the man said. Doesn't look like much now."
"That's because the chickens are out and everything's dirty. Nobody wants to buy dirty eggs. You'll have to wash up the place and make sure those chickens get back to their pens and get their baths too. Then you'll have people lining up to buy Hauʻolikamoa eggs again."
"What does that mean, anyway?" Saffron had seen the words on a sign when she'd pulled up to the farm.
"The happy chicken," the old man said, and cast his bright smile toward her.
It was hard not to like him, even with her head pounding.
"I'm Mano. Aloha."
Saffron knew that she was supposed to say aloha back, but it felt pretentious somehow, as if she were using something that didn't belong to her. Instead, she just said, "I'm Saffron. Nice to meet you." She couldn't shake his hand because her arms were full of cleaning supplies, but she gave him the best smile she could muster. "Thanks for the information. I'll try to get the chickens gathered and everything cleaned up. Would you mind telling people that the place is for sale?" Mano nodded.
"I'll let them know. Good luck out there. Big job."
He paused for a moment.
"Do you want some help?"
Saffron had always been suspicious of people who wanted to help. "No, I'm fine," she said. "Thanks anyway." She turned and got to the checkout before he could offer again. There was something cathartic about clearing off the bed. Saffron was astounded at the sheer number of empty egg cartons Uncle Bo had stacked there. It took her several trips to carry them to the hallway, where she stacked them atop several other piles. Beneath them were boxes of books and photo frames. Lifting the heavy boxes to the floor and stripping off the dingy blankets and sheets, she was pleased to find an almost new mattress and a beautiful koa wood bed frame. She wiped the dust from it and traced the glossy, curling grain of the wood with her fingers. Carved into it were pineapples, coconuts, and banana leaves. She'd had a wall-mounted stainless steel headboard back at the Yardley. There had been no place for dust to collect, and her bedroom had been just big enough to walk around the bed to the narrow closet. This place was different. The bungalow was sprawling and earthy. She could picture it tidy and decorated, a Hawaiian home anyone would love to have. This bed alone would bring two or three times as much as one of the fancy wedding dresses she'd helped brides pick out back home. Her mouth turned bitter with a rush of anxiety. Every detail of Ents was being run by her assistants, Trish and Clark, in her absence, and several important events were coming up. That's why she needed to get this done quickly. She needed to get back to her life. She calmed her panic by reminding herself that she was here because of her business, not in spite of it. According to Rose, her real estate agent, the money from this sale would be enough to pay for the new office space at the Viridian in one of the most lush districts of D.C., a standing ad in D.C. Bride, and a brand new van to ferry decorations and food to the venues. She'd driven her sedan in D.C. rush hour with 6-foot dressmaker's dummies wrapped in tulle sticking over her shoulder, and very nearly brushing a 3-tier Remy Callahan wedding cake, and she was not doing that again. The extra capital from this sale had the potential to solve those startup problems and launch her into the top event planners in D.C. She tried not to think about the fact that this time last year, she'd been expecting to plan her own wedding. It had been penciled in for next weekend, but that was before Reggie went to Honolulu. She vacuumed and scrubbed, hauled and cleared, until the master bedroom and bath were shining and bare. The wood floor shone warm and sleek under the wide windows. She'd even cleaned the wood fan blades. The tawny tones of the wood throughout the room made the place feel welcoming. She spread the surfboard sheets on the bed and stood back to admire the room. Her efforts had paid off. It was an oasis in the sea of clutter. It was dark outside now, and Saffron wandered to the kitchen and ate a handful of macadamia nuts from a can she'd bought at the airport. Glancing through the cupboards, she saw plenty of boxes, cans, and bags, but she didn't trust any food in here. She wished she'd stopped at the bright little paradise market she'd seen on the town's main street. The chicken in the pot clucked her annoyance at Saffron's intrusion. Saffron was too tired to put her out right now. She simply didn't have the energy for another chicken roundup. All she wanted was sleep. "All right, all right. One more night of freeloading for you," she told the chicken as she switched off the light and stumbled from the kitchen. "But I'm getting you out of here tomorrow." She felt like she could breathe properly in the tidy bedroom. In fact, she could almost forget the catastrophe outside the bedroom door, and she was so tired, she almost forgot she'd been hungry. Saffron pulled off her grimy clothes and unzipped her suitcase. On top were her soft gray pajamas and her toothbrush. She went into the little master bath and brushed her teeth. She stripped off the remaining smudges of her makeup and dabbed at her face with the soft pineapple towels. Saffron slipped into the surfboard sheets. In her dreams, she was chasing chickens. It was a noisy squawk from the kitchen chicken that woke her in the middle of the night and made her sit up. Saffron pushed the fog of sleep from her mind and listened. Footsteps. Someone was walking in the house. The wavering beam of a flashlight jittered away the shadows in the hallway. Saffron squinted against the splashes of color the beam revealed in the darkened hall. "Who's there?" Saffron called. The light disappeared, and Saffron looked around for something to defend herself with. She heard the creak of the floorboards as the intruder retreated. She jumped up and moved to the bedroom door, where she snapped on the bedroom light and then, reaching around the doorframe, the hall light. Saffron's chest was tight with fear. She'd lived in D.C. her whole life and never had a break-in. She'd been here for bare hours, and someone was in her house. The back door screeched, and Saffron stepped quickly down the hall to see if she could catch a glimpse of the fleeing perpetrator. By the time she reached the door, though, and closed and locked it, she could see no one outside under the wan yard light through the grimy glass. The kitchen didn't seem so ominous now that the lights were on. The hen on the stove was making a soft, insistent thrumming sound. Saffron recognized it as a warning. For the first time in her life, Saffron understood why people kept pets. It was nice knowing that there was another living creature with her. Nothing in the kitchen seemed disturbed. Saffron walked through into the living room. That was where the burglar had concentrated. She could see streaks in the dust where his fingers had gripped a box or peeled back a flap. One box had been upended on the single remaining space on the futon, its contents scattered and vaguely sorted. She wondered how long the person had been in the house before she'd woken up. The thought made her squirm. Still, an empty house full of stuff was bound to draw thieves. They probably didn't even know she was here. And even the little changes she'd made would be hard to spot amid the flotsam and jetsam of Uncle Beau's life. The intruder had fled through the back door, which looked out on the yard, the little cottages, and the steep mountainside beyond the farm, so he probably didn't see her car sitting out front. She sat on the floor next to the futon and looked at the contents of the dumped box. It seemed to be a conglomeration of old military items. There were brass pins with eagles and crosses, colored bars, ribbons. There was a cloth-covered canteen, a field manual for a rifle regiment, and a set of dog tags. Saffron recognized her grandfather's name on them. Everything was worn and faded. Nothing stood out as particularly valuable, but it did seem there might be missing items. There was a shadow box laying face down on the futon. Its back had been popped off and left beside it. The display surface was black velvet, badly faded except for one spot. Saffron could clearly see the shape of a knife with a thick handle and a curved blade. There was a paper tag pasted to the velvet that read, "The knife that saved my life in Germany." It must have belonged to her grandfather when he fought in World War II. He'd left from this very island after the Pearl Harbor attack. So the thief had taken at least the knife, and maybe more. The box was much bigger than it needed to be to hold these few bits of memorabilia. Saffron shivered as she ran her finger along the edge of the knife silhouette. The intruder had probably been carrying this when she shouted out and scared him away. Saffron looked around. She had no way of telling if anything else had been taken. The daunting mountains of Uncle Bo's possessions cast heavy shadows in the glare of the overhead light, and Saffron shrugged. The burglar didn't know it, but he was probably doing her a favor carting some of it away. Saffron made a call to the emergency dispatcher.
"Maikai City Services," said a woman's voice. "What is the nature of your emergency?"
"Someone's broken into my house," Saffron said.
"Is the intruder still there?"
The woman's words weren't rushed, and her tone conveyed no urgency. Rather, she seemed interested in the story.
"No," Saffron said. "I think I scared him off."
"Did you know the person?" the woman asked.
"No, I don't know anybody here."
Saffron supposed she had, technically, met one person, Manot, but that didn't seem relevant.
"Would you like an officer to respond?"
"Don't they just do that anyway?" Saffron found that she was already peering out the window, expecting to see flashing lights approaching from the main road.
"See, we only have the one officer here," the woman said, still conversational. "And Maikai is the safest town on the island, so we don't usually have to dispatch for every call."
Was she chewing gum? Saffron winced.
"Officer Bradley can come out in a while," the dispatcher said, "but he's on another call right now, a domestic thing over at Rod Peter's house."
Saffron wondered if the woman should be telling her this. "And he probably won't be back for an hour or so, but I can send him your way when he comes back."
Saffron stuttered out her agreement and tapped her phone to end the call. If this was the safest town on Oahu, Maikai City Services seemed to have little credit to take for that.
Chapter 2. Light was beginning to touch the sky over the sea outside the front windows, but it was still very early. Saffron returned to the bedroom and tried to go back to sleep. But even though her arms ached and her vision was blurry with fatigue, her mind would not shut off and allow sleep to return. She kept seeing that figure, knowing that he'd been in the house while she slept. In addition to the fear, she was also still on DC time, and she felt as awake as if it was 2 in the afternoon. She figured she might as well go through some of the boxes while she waited for the sun to catch up with her. The hall outside the master bedroom was stacked with boxes and crates and piles she'd emptied from the room yesterday. She switched on the lights and started with a beautiful old crate that had juicy pineapple wood burned into the side of it. She could have used it for a trendy cake stand at a vintage wedding event. Inside was a stack of books, everything from Getting Started with Landscaping to an early edition of Gone with the Wind. She set them aside. She'd have to check and see if any of them were worth selling. If not, they'd make great centerpieces, especially for a booksy wedding. The next crate held more books, and the third was filled with photos in frames. A much younger Uncle Bo held a baby in the top one, and as she went down, she saw more of his life. His wedding, his service in the Navy, his childhood. She flipped the last frame over. It was an exquisite silver creation, ornate and interwoven. In its center, staring out at Saffron, were the eyes of her father. The young slate sky stood with Uncle Bo and her grandparents on the beach, a line of waves breaking in the water behind them.
the boys were not yet 10 years old, their wide eyes and bright smiles unlike the men she remembered. Her father had left when Saffron was a toddler. Her only memory of him was his goodbye, as he leaned down over her crib and kissed her on the forehead. The memory was colored with the electric blue of his eyes, a color she had only seen a few times since. Once on a tropical fish, and once in a lightning-lit night sky. And she had only come to know Uncle Beau when he was old. He'd come to her mother with cash for her medical bills, and though not even that could save her, it had lessened the stress for them considerably. Uncle Beau had visited regularly until the end, 6 years ago, and then she hadn't heard from him until his attorney called with the news. Saffron slid the photo back into the box and piled the other frames on top of it. Some things, Saffron felt, should stay buried. A ragged blast of sound from the porch made her jump. The rooster had apparently spent the night out there and was letting her know that day was dawning. He crowed twice more just to be sure she was up. Saffron was ravenous. She headed for the kitchen and was all the way there before she realized there'd be no cooking today. The kitchen needed cleaning, and there was still a chicken on the stove. The nest the hen had made in the pot looked soft and tidy. In fact, right then the hen was carefully tucking an errant straw into the nest, weaving it carefully back under another so the end didn't stick out. Saffron couldn't help but like her. They shared a love of neatness. Still, it wasn't neat to have a chicken living on the stove. "You've got to go," Saffron said, moving over to open the door. Maybe she could scare it out like she had the rooster. Only he was there waiting like a salesman. Saffron closed the door before he could come in. He crowed again. She'd have to grab the chicken and put her out. She approached the pot, eliciting a low warning trill from the hen. "Don't get sassy with me," she said. "I own this house. You're just squatting." The hen tipped her head and, incredibly, seemed to grow larger. Saffron stepped back. "You know, the last time I was this close to a chicken, it was at the Bombay Club in D.C., and it was in my chicken tikka masala." This didn't seem to bother the hen. Her trill had now become more rapid, and the low sounds blended into each other to make an unnerving growl. "And you look like tikka, too. You're the same color. And believe me, I know color." Saffron studied the hen. Saffron's unique color vision was paired with a remarkable color memory. Saffron carried in her mind a catalog of every color she'd ever seen, and could match tints she saw to ones she'd seen years ago. The simmering orange of the hen's feathers, the way they seemed made of reds and golds and a hint of violet, was a perfect match for the rich tikka masala sauce back in D.C. "In fact, that's your new name. I'm calling you Tikka." She thought this might intimidate the hen, but it just pulled back its head closer to its body and swelled even more. Saffron shifted her weight from one foot to the other. The hen, round and full, had the most remarkable feathers. They were a vibrant golden orange with stark black edging. They came to a rounded point and made her look like she was wearing armor. Saffron was growing less confident about picking her up. The rooster crowed outside. Saffron glanced through the window and saw him perching on the railing of the lanai, swiveling his rusty head to stare at her through the window. The steel blue points on his feathers rippled across each other like chain mail. "You want a name too?" Saffron called to him. "I'm calling you Curry." The rooster didn't seem intimidated either. In fact, he ticked his head up and down, as if nodding approval. "You can't stay here," she said, turning her attention back to Tikka. "Nobody's going to buy a house with a chicken living in it." Saffron backed away, trying to think. Maybe she should have taken the old man up on his offer to help. The hen quieted as Saffron retreated. Saffron froze. As the hen settled down, another sound was clear. It was a high squeak, insistent and delicate. Mice? No, this was much too constant. It was coming from the pot. And then she realized. Tika, you old rascal, she said. You've got a baby in there. No wonder the hen was so reticent to vacate. Saffron stilled and waited. When Tika seemed sure that she was no longer threatened, she shifted slightly. The fuzzy black head of a chick peeked out from under her mother's wing. It was the chick that was making all the noise now. Tika tucked the little ball of fluff back under her wing and shifted again. Underneath the hen, several more eggs were visible. Tika tucked her head under herself and brought it back out, nudging half of the empty shell the chick must have come from out of the nest. She repeated the process and pushed out the other half. The shells fell to the stovetop with a hollow sound. The hatch must have just begun. Well played, Tika, she said. I certainly can't move you right now, can I? The rooster crowed from outside again. You're not coming back in, Saffron called to him. She moved away from the hen and grabbed her caddy of cleaning supplies from the sink. At least we can keep your babies from hatching in a filthy kitchen, she said. Saffron filled two garbage bags with old cans and boxes of food. She ran three loads of dishes through the dishwasher and scrubbed the cupboards until her knuckles hurt. It was in the top cupboard that she found the second hidden compartment. Behind the teacups, a sliding wood panel was built back into the wall. She never would have seen it if she hadn't been scrubbing an ages-old ring left by a dried-up bottle of molasses. The agitation shook the panel just loose enough to make a hairline crack revealed by the strong light Saffron had set up to see into all the corners. Carefully, she slid back the panel. At first, she could make out nothing in the small dark space, but she adjusted the light, and the lumpy outline of a black velvet bag appeared. Saffron could tell as soon as she hefted it that there were coins inside. She moved to the newly scrubbed table. Tika watched her with interest as she poured the clinking treasure out onto the table. Four gold coins slid out, along with two old U.S. passports. The coins, each showing a woman's head surrounded by stars on the front and an eagle made from a shield on the back, were marked 1898. The passports belonged to her grandparents. As she cracked them open, a little note fell out of her grandmother's. Beth, just a little mad money to get you home for a visit. Come whenever you have the time, and bring our precious grandsons. It was signed by Lulabel Hardy, Saffron's great-grandmother on her grandmother's side. She thought about the distance between Minnesota and Hawaii, and how her grandmother had come with her grandfather here when he came to work for the fruit companies. From what she understood, that had only lasted a few years before he bought his own farm and built this house. Saffron knew what it felt like to miss your mother. She had, suddenly, a new appreciation for her Grandma Beth, out here in the islands. She wondered if she'd ever seen her mother again. The ties of family had to stretch pretty far without breaking back in those days. Saffron didn't know how much the coins were worth, but she suspected they were valuable. She put them back in the bag and stowed them where she'd found them. This house was full of surprises. When the kitchen was clean and the boxes had been moved into the living room for later sorting, Saffron made her way outside. She blinked at the explosion of color that greeted her. DC's overwhelming color was gray. Gray monuments, gray streets, often gray skies. Here, the verdant green almost hurt her eyes. There were deep greens composed of azure streaks and gold sheens. Neon greens with overtones of magenta and lemon. Dusty greens that held bronze and bluebell tones. Everywhere she looked, layers of plants were growing. Cerulean grass on the ground, knee-high bushes, emerald shrubs the size of houses. And above it all, towering palm trees with clusters of coconuts that seemed impossibly high. Saffron slid her sunglasses on. There was only so much color she could stand. The farm was alive with chickens. They were scratching the grass, rolling in the sand, and chasing each other around the yard. Their feathers came in every color, and within those colors, more colors. Black with violet and turquoise overtones, tangerine with shimmering aqua and splashes the color of sunshine. Looking at their plumage was a treat to Saffron. Still, she felt the old twitch of annoyance at something out of place. She wanted them in their pens, as the old man had said, clean and useful, and most of all, contained. She walked toward a group of them, and they scattered. As she had learned with Curry, rounding them up wasn't going to be easy. A flash in the undergrowth drew Saffron's attention. She walked toward it and crouched where she could peer into the bush. There she saw the smooth, ovoid shapes of several eggs, resting in a depression filled with dried grass and leaves. It was a nest. She supposed there were many such caches of eggs throughout the property. One more reason the chickens should be in their pens. This nest was so well camouflaged that she would never have seen it if she weren't looking at just the right angle. Gathering eggs to sell from dozens of such wild hidden nests would take forever. Flowers grew on many of the trees and bushes. The whole place smelled sweet, and the fresh breeze from the ocean on the other side of the house left Saffron feeling rejuvenated. A police cruiser came nosing into the driveway. Saffron walked around the house and met the officer as he climbed out of his car. He was a stocky man with a square jaw, early 50s. He had a weathered face that had seen, Saffron could tell, a lot. The officer held his face taut, with a callous indifference evident in the set of his mouth. His name tag said, Bradley. "Had a call about a break-in?" he said. His voice was flinty.
"Right. Someone was in my house last night."
"Your house?"
Saffron felt defensive.
"My uncle Beau left it to me. I just got here from D.C. yesterday."
"Ah."
Bradley breathed a long, exasperated sigh.
"I see."
Saffron wondered what he saw, but the officer didn't expound.
"You want to take those glasses off?"
he asked. His tone was authoritative, so Saffron obliged. Without her sunglasses, she could see the blue tinge to his jaw, where his beard would be if he weren't clean-shaven. She felt more confident somehow when she could fully assess her surroundings with her full range of color vision. She looked him in the eye.
"They take anything?"
He didn't seem to want to use any more words than he had to.
"Maybe?"
she tried to explain. "I'm not sure, I just got here, and this is my uncle's stuff, and..."
"So nothing that was important to you?"
"Well, I don't think so. Maybe some of my grandpa's army stuff."
Saffron was going to continue, but Bradley cut her off again.
"Did you engage the intruder?"
Saffron shook her head.
"No, he ran off when he figured out I was here."
Bradley shrugged.
"Probably local kids. This place has been vacant a long time, and they mess around, you know?"
Saffron felt he should be a little more concerned.
"I know kids can be mischievous, but..."
"Look, miss, I am the only officer here. I know out in Washington there's whole fleets of personnel ready to swoop in whenever somebody disagrees with their neighbor or has a hangnail. But I have been out all night dealing with people whose lives depend on me showing up to stop their abusive husbands from sending them to the hospital. You get why I'm not that worried about some kids daring each other to go into an abandoned house? I'm looking around and I'm just not seeing any immediate danger here."
There was nothing more to be said.
"I guess I just wanted to make a report, so you'd know somebody is breaking in on your beat."
"I appreciate that. But in the future, don't call unless you're in real peril. You're not in D.C. anymore."
Saffron didn't say anything as she slipped her sunglasses back on and watched him climb back into his cruiser.
he flipped a U-turn in the yard. Last night's incident suddenly seemed less threatening and more absurd, and she supposed she was at least glad to be feeling angry now instead of afraid. The heartbeat of the ocean came to her in the sound of the steady waves on the beach ahead. From where she was standing in the yard, she could see the blue curls of its reaching swells. She let the sound calm her. Framing the view of the ocean was a long, zigzagging line of palm trees, unbroken except for a 30-yard stretch that gave a perfect ocean view from the picture window in the living room behind her. The golden sand of the beach cast a happy glow around the scene. Saffron let her gaze follow the tree line south, where just a couple hundred yards away, the trees grew thick at the base of an enormous lava rock point that protruded hundreds of feet out into the sea. The waves broke against it in a violent spray, foam chasing them back out before they rushed tirelessly to batter the point again. Saffron wondered absently how long it would take for the water to wear it away. Not ready to go back in yet, Saffron wandered down the driveway to the back of the house. A vast lawn separated the main bungalow from three little cottages where the workers on her grandfather's farm used to live. She wasn't surprised to find that Uncle Beau had filled them with more stuff. They were little square buildings containing a couple bedrooms, one bath, a small living room, and a kitchen. Wide screen lanais held dusty wicker furniture and made an extra outdoor room.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.